And a very good evening, everybody. Welcome into your box seat, brought to you in association with Sweet Lou, standing at Woodlands. The team are back together. Craig Thompson back in winning form, prime power. As I say, a very good evening to you.
Good evening, Greg. Michael and the viewers as well. Yeah, big performance, wasn't it, Friday night, off 40 metres. It's never easy to come off a big handicap, and he was only, I think, 0.8 outside his personal best in doing that. He hadn't won a race since October 2015, so good to see him back winning. The problem he's probably got, Greg, if he goes forward and keeps racing, is obviously going back further in the handicap's got to make it tougher, but good on Todd Mitchell for persevering and getting a win.
All right, I've got some more news on him as the show goes on too. Like Lazarus returning at Addington on Friday night, Michael Guerin's back. Evening, mate.
Yeah, hi fellas, nice to be back, and a big hi to everybody at home. I'll be honest, I didn't miss you either when I was away, and I didn't miss harness racing. I've had 10 days away, and it's been good for me. We had a big 6 months, October till the Auckland Cup Carnival, or Derby Week as it's called now, and had a break, ditch all that, and then move forward. And as you know, moving forward for the next 3 months tends to be about the duels, and we've had our first duels invite given out last night for the Australian runners, so we're starting to think now about where these age group horses are. But gee, come back at a good week, boys. I mean, it feels like such a long time since we've had a really good meeting at Addington. And it's disappointing we don't have more good meetings, but the calendar's so spread between the two islands that this Friday night is the best meeting, Greg, I think, since Cup Week.
Yep, no doubt about that. And we didn't miss you at all either, mate. Matt Cross did an outstanding job, in fact.
I don't care. No,
he
Matt,
took the winner.
Matt's too young to be doing this show. He needs another 10 years on him at least, I think.
All right.
That's the email I sent to the bosses anyway.
Right, let's move into the show. Chris and me, of course, as reported on your box seat, is heading to the States, and this is what Dexter Dunn had to say about him. All horses have character, great horses are intelligent. You were both, you succeeded in races I couldn't have dreamed of winning. And I thought that's fantastic for a guy who doesn't get emotional very often, Dexter Dunn, for him to go into social media and say those things about this wonderful horse was a really nice moment, I thought.
Well, first of all, it's a good use of social media. I think social media is a really powerful tool in racing, but it's badly used. Most people use it to rant on Facebook and criticise other people. If you're going to use it, try and use it for at least intelligent criticism.
Or positiveness.
Or positivity.
Yeah.
And it also shows us that these great horses aren't machines. They're not motorbikes with reins. Here he is winning the Auckland Cup, of course. No, they are a part of people's lives. So, Craig, he's a better horse than his legacy will remember him as, because had they retired him, had he been injured 2 years ago, he would have retired with a Miracle Mile, Auckland Cup, New Zealand Free for All, Hunter Cup, Victoria Cup, and people would have gone, wow. But because of what's happened in the last 2 years, he has lost some of his luster through no one's fault. He got that virus, he didn't come back as well, and it's been a battle for them, and ultimately it's a battle they've lost.
Yeah, and with Dexter, I think he won 32 races, 26 of them in New Zealand, and Dexter was aboard all 26 times. So you can understand his emotion about the horse, because I think Dexter started driving in 2007. This horse started winning his first race in 2012. It was when Dexter was really making that step as a New Zealand number one leading driver. This horse took him to places all around the country, all around the world. So yeah, he's going to miss the old bloke. And hey, boys, I think in America they can treat horses that have his problems, so that's where his future lies.
All right, that was him beating Terra to Love, of course, in the Easter Cup. Outstanding win in the Miracle Mile when he beat Bow Tide, who was at his peak at that stage.
But the Miracle Mile was very good. I was lucky enough to be there that night, but I think the Auckland Cup was his best win. 3.13 will stand as a record, I think, for a long time. Most of our records these days won't stand for that long, but the 3.13 coming from last, beating a champion near and adore me in her last race. He had an interrupted preparation into that race. He played up before the race. A lot of things went wrong. He didn't win a New Zealand Cup, and it's hard to call him a champion even though he won more good races than many of the champions, because he also had a lot of big losing streaks. The last 2 years I'm willing to forgive, but he had a 9-race losing streak at one point where he was pulling up all the time, and I thought, you've turned into half a cat. But then Dexter nursed him through that, and he won a Hunter Cup, and then, of course, he had that string where he won the New Zealand Free for All, Auckland Cup, Miracle Mile, and Victoria Cup. So he was a great horse. I don't think he was a champion. A lot of people out there watching this would say, why have they sold this horse? Well, clearly, you can do one of two things. He has to be retired here, because it looks like, I would suggest by the American fact, he might have had a slight bleeding issue. Mm. I don't know that for a fact, but I would suggest that. So he's gone to the US where he can race on Lasix, or they can retire him. Now, he's quite an athletic, racy type of horse. I'm not sure he would have been a good retirement horse. There'll be some people saying, why would you send him offshore for that money? I understand those sentiments too. Had he been mine, I would have retired him to here. But that's not my money to say, well, I don't need it.
Mm.
So there's two sides to every story. I would like to see him come home to retire, Craig, but again, that's not my decision to make.
And it's very unlikely, given they've sold him outright.
It is.
Well, I think with Michael's assessment of what his future lies and where it lies, it was either retirement or America, because that's where you treat the problem that he's got. So, hey, I tend to agree with you, Michael. You don't need the money. Maybe those owners do.
Yeah, maybe.
Well, and the other thing too is, it is a business. I mean, Charlie Roberts and Vicky Purden, the other owner, they've owned a lot of horses. So you have to be unemotional about turning them over from time to time. So, as I said, there's two sides to that argument.
Also, I suppose what you look at, we'll get off the subject very quickly, but I think he's had 62 starts. He's been very lightly raced for an eight-year-old. So it's not like he's going around for 150 starts or Destrios go around 400 starts. Sure enough, he's won $2.5 million, but over a period of 5 years, 60 starts, you're averaging 10 starts a year. He's not been overtaxed.
I tell you what he does do. He continues the curse of the horses of the year. In recent years, the horse of the year or the leading trotter of the year in pace, gee, they've had a bad run. A couple of years ago, he looked like he had the world at his feet and then the wheels fell off completely. Have Faith in Me last year. The wheels have fallen off there. Mombay had an interrupted season this year after winning Horse of the Year. And we've had a lot of it in recent years, which goes to show you how tough it is to start at the top. It's not like the old days where Bonnie's Chance and Hounds Down keep coming back every year and battling every year. The stress on the body these days with the 147s, and we're seeing that with the Door Me, it's really hard to keep backing up at that level.
Pleased to have you back. You never have much to say on these subjects, which is fantastic.
No, when we review next week's races, I won't, because I haven't seen them.
No, right. Let's move on to Friday night at Addington. He's back, Lazarus. Wonderful to have him back at Addington. It's the 4 and 5 year old Superstars Championship with Resource Recycling Technology, and this is him, of course, preparing for an ultimate win in the Victoria Cup, and he did it in such great style there. Here's the market for this race, which the club changed to 4 and 5 year old a couple of seasons ago now, and I think it clearly has worked, because without them in this race, it would have been hard to run it, Michael.
I think they would have got a bigger field with an Lazarus. I think he might scare a few away, but then again, you're still up against Heaven Rocks and Field Marshal and very, very good horses. Craig, I think $1.20 is fair, because he should lead. There's no blazing gate speed around him. You would suggest most of them will fall into single file behind him, and he's never been beaten in front, and he started favourite in a miracle mile. So in front here, $1.20 is fair.
Totally concur. That's what he'll start at, and it's a fair price. I mean, of the other runners, let's go back and have a look at his last start, well, two starts ago, when he was a very impressive winner of the Victoria Cup. Inside draw here, he'll punch through 1,900 metres. He's only been beaten once at this distance. He should find the front, and then he'll dictate from there. It'll be only a horse like Heaven Rocks, if they light him up at the start, would get round him, that Lazarus would let go. I don't think he'd ever let a Field Marshal go, so... Hey, I see him leading, I see him winning.
All right, Heaven Rocks, of course, starts from the unruly, so he's going to be allowed to settle early, so he might get there by the winning post, but even then, I reckon Lazarus beat him for speed potentially anyway.
Well, I mean, let's be honest. I mean, Heaven Rocks is a very good horse, but he's Heaven Rocks. Mm. I mean, Lazarus won the New Zealand Cup by 10 lengths. Here he is, Heaven Rocks, and clearly he's a very, very good horse. He's in second place here. Natalie elected to trail, pulls out this last 100 metres. He just turbocharges. Put it to Mark Purden last night. I said, I'm going on the show tomorrow. What's your best guess? He said, look, I don't think he'll beat him this week. I don't think Lazarus is beatable this week. I said, where is he? He said, I'm very happy with him. There's no issues. We're tickety-boo, ready to go. After this race, he won't go to the Easter Cup. Heaven Rocks will go to the Easter Cup. Then Heaven Rocks will go to the Messenger. Lazarus and Waikiki Beach will head north and go to the Taylor Mile and the Messenger. I said, well, was there any chance Heaven Rocks could beat Lazarus this season? He said, yeah, under the right circumstances, he has a big enough motor that he could beat Laz, but I don't think it'll be this week. So now you know as much as we know.
Yep, and of course, if he does take his hook and takes on Lazarus with a lap to go, he'd get the lead because he's that powerful. And if that did unfold, it'll be interesting to see.
I don't reckon he would. Mm. Well, because if one horse has never been beaten in front, if Mark hands up on a $1.10 chance, I reckon he'll start, and gets beat,
And would you want to take 370 about a horse that, hey, sure, he got it right at Alexandra Park on two occasions, but his previous five
didn't.
He's
overdue.
He is not a $3.70 chance.
If you're taking 370 about Heaven Rocks this week, you are out of your mind.
All right. The other horse resuming is Field Marshal, and lucky enough, I caught up with Tim Butt yesterday to see where he's at. Tim, we haven't seen him since the New Zealand free-for-all. I know he's had a couple of public appearances, but that's a decent break off for this horse.
Yeah, he just had a little few little niggly problems, nothing serious, Greg, and he was going to miss the Hunter Cup sort of period, so we thought we'd give him a bit longer out and, you know, aim for the winter and some Aussie racing. But, you know, he's a great horse, and I just hope he's back to his best. He seems terrific.
All right, so he's come through those couple of trials. He lines up at Addington this week. His fresh record's very good. What are your expectations?
Oh, he'll go well. You know, it's just a class opposition. You know, he's raced against best horse in Australasia, so and Heaven's Rock's probably not far behind him. So, you know, if we can keep up, we'll be going pretty good.
That Aussie campaign you talk about, I'm assuming you mean Brisbane?
Yeah, hopefully we'll head to the Australia at the end of the month for a race called the Bull Eye Cup, and there's a good 75 grand race down in Melton, so, and then, you know, the Len Smith Mile, and so could have 2.5 months over there, all going well, so just got to perform these next couple of weeks.
All right, he's a good horse, and we'll catch up with Tim Butt on the night. He's a decent team in on Friday night, and it's good to see the stable are certainly firing. All right, that's the 34th running of the Superstars. The Breeders is the 45th edition, and back in 2006 it changed to 2,600 metres. All the good horses, all the good mares win this.
The great mares win this. Bonnie's Chance won the Breeders in the last ever start. That's how long I remember this race being part of my life. Really surprised by the market here, Craig. I mean, the Orange Agent beat Smolder last start, and she was fantastic. But Piccadilly Princess has probably been no inferior after a massive summer. I thought they'd be very close in the market, maybe each a $2.40. $3, pick Princess versus the Orange Agent drawn wider at $1.90. I think that's very, very fair. Here is Piccadilly Princess. She went Perth, she went to Melbourne, then she went to Menangle, sat parked, and won the ladyship like a very, very good mare. I'm not sure, fellas, that the Orange Agent would have gone any better here.
No, I don't. And I think the bookmakers have got it the wrong way around, because I think on tote closing, you'll have Piccadilly Princess favourite. Now, she went to the trials on Monday in atrocious conditions, trailed Waikiki Beach the whole way, and I thought went as good, if not better, than Waikiki Beach up the lane. She got the perfect draw, barrier number two. I think she deserves to start favourite on her form in Australia. I'm not saying that the Orange Agent isn't going good. You reverse the draws, you reverse the favouritism. But I think the bookmakers have got it wrong here.
All right, so they'll flip it round, you think, in terms of the odds by the time we go. Here's the Orange Agent. Great to have her back. Have her back in winning form, fantastic. And like you say, the million-dollar earner from the last season is the horse she got past here.
Yeah, well, she beats three very, very good horses here. She's beating Have Faith in Me. There's Smolder in front, and there's her going to the passing lane. She's one of the few mares in recent times good enough to beat the boys, Adore Me and Dream About Me being the other two. She's drawn one, two or three, fellas. I'll take $1.60, but she's not. Now, I put that to Mark Purden last night when I rang him and said, look, what do you make of this? He said, well, I've got to stay in front. Piccadilly Princess, we've got to stay in front. We can't just give her the lead because then she'll disappear and win. So if that happens, and these tactics change all the time, they're never guaranteed, but if that happens, then you're backing the Orange Agent to cover more ground than Piccadilly Princess and beat her. I think the Orange Agent flat out is a better horse. I think if you put them in a straight line, 100 times they raced, I think the Orange Agent would win more races than Piccadilly Princess. But it's not in a straight line. The barrier draws suggest Piccadilly Princess has an advantage. I think it'll be close to each of two in the favouritism. The $3 at the moment is very good value.
What did Mark tell you about Golden Goddess? Because we haven't seen her publicly, although she did trial in a quasi-trial meeting that they had at Addington as a result of Rangi Ora being called
off. He told me exactly what you'd expect, Greg, which is very few horses, virtually none, win Group 1s fresh up over 2,600 after that bigger break. And she's a big, solid thing anyway. I said, what do you think? He said, look, I can't see her beating the other two. And I don't see her being a factor in the race because I can't see her being forward enough, Craig, to go and attack either of the horses, which is her natural racing style. Mm. So I'm willing to wait on her, thinking that maybe the jewels further down the line is her go. The other big question mark out of the race.
Well, she's got to get some earnings, though, hasn't
she? Agreed. Yeah, agreed. Well, Dream About Me, obviously, is out of this race. Do we think we're going to see her again this season?
I don't think so. No.
Probably not. Just on Piccadilly Prince, I'm a little bit different to maybe the school of thought going round. I don't see her as the leader of this race early.
You see Better Be Amazed?
I see Better Be Amazed or The Orange Agent. Particularly Princess on Australia, when she drew Handy, was expected to lead, and Rocker Band got her easily off the gate there. I think very similar circumstances here. The Orange Agent may get across quickly from the start. She is very fast off the gate here. Mm. Better Be Amazed would be quite happy to take a sit. They both trialled with each other last Saturday at Pukekohe. I thought they both went very well. They ran home in 26 last quarter and they both hit the line well. They're at the top of the game, one's significantly better than the other, the Orange Agent, and Better Be Amazed. But I think the $3 around Piccadilly Princess is value. I'm not saying I'd back her, because I don't think she'll be in front, but she's certainly value.
Ooh, well, if you're right, and I had factored that in, if you're right, then the Orange Agent will be winning. If she runs to the front, it's just a game over job. But
I wouldn't take $1.90.
Well, I'm always willing to back horses who come out of Australian racing with improved gate speed because they learn to race off the gate so much harder. And I think that'll be their plan. But it'll make the first 200 really interesting.
What I would say is, if you're going to back the Orange Agent, don't do it now. Hmm. I think she'll drift in the market, and I think she'll close 240.
Well, that's the other crucial factor. Friday night, get a lot of coverage on Sky 2 in Australia. There'll be a lot of Australian money in this pool. They know these horses, but they have seen Piccadilly Princess win in three different states. So the money will be for her. Hmm. So I agree with you. On the tote, the Orange Agent will more than likely be the drifter.
All right, the Vero Flying Stakes is always the key lead-up race towards next week's Diamond Creek New Zealand Derby. We've got the Sire Stakes and Sale Series winner in Ultimate Machete. We've got the New South Wales Derby winner in Vincent in there. We've got the Northern Derby winner in Rakapuka Ruler. AG's White Sox being crawled by the draw, but $1.80 for Ultimate Machete, is that enough?
Again, I didn't know enough about these two and where they sit at the moment because, you know, one's been away from racing for a month, the other one has raced and, of course, was terribly unlucky. Here's the big fella, of course, coming wide, sets him at the outside of the picture. Enormous when second in the Northern Derby. Rakapuka Ruler, you still can't take the credit away from him, but the run of the race was the second horse. I said to Mark, look, you got the better of the draws this week with Ultimate Machete, or what she has, Natalie's driving him, of course. Can he use it? He said, look, I think we have to. I think we have to use the gate speed and try and get him off the gate and go forward. I got the inkling that they were thinking they could potentially lead with Ultimate Machete. And if they do, then it's his race to lose. Mm. Vincent, I think the gap's closed. Here is that gap closing at Menangle. That's Ultimate Machete in front. Vincent's on his back and comes off his back. But Craig, I don't see him being on the marker pegs this week, Vincent, because I think even if he does go forward at the start, there's enough gate speed inside him that he'll have to do too much work. I think it's advantage, Ultimate Machete, with the barrier draws here.
I agree with you when on paper it looks that way. I just wonder whether neither of them get the front early. I think they'll eventually grab the front, but I think there's enough gate speed, especially inside with a horse like Billy Badger, to hold them early. Now, I'm not saying he's going to stay there, but tactically off the gate, he's quick enough to hold both of those runners. Ultimate Machete, he's racing a bit dour, 1,950 metres. You could see him working there, but taking time to get there, a little bit like last start to get round the field. Whereas Vincent's got probably more get up and go early. Very interesting to see what happens inside the first 400 metres. I certainly wouldn't take $1.80 around Ultimate Machete. And I'm not saying he can't win the race because he was outstanding in defeat last start. But I do think this race is a little bit of a tricky race. 1,950 here, they can go very hard early. Vincent, I do like his price.
And that track at Addington's absolutely on fire at this stage, so they could run any time there. The Lamb and Haywood 4 and 5 year old trotting championship won last year, of course, by Mumbai. The back mark is here off the 30 metres. Normally, Michael, I'd have a little bit of trepidation about those, but when you've got Habib Di Ivy, everybody knows, and Wilma's Mate, you know they're going to be moving together, and I think they have the wood on these.
Look, I think Wilma's Mate's too short for a horse who doesn't have the fitness base that a Habibti Ivy, and obviously everybody knows, does. Everybody Knows has been the horse, Craig, that's really surprised me this year. Little fella, and he's not an inspiring looking horse, but he's so tough, just keeps on trucking. What am I going to back in this race? Probably nothing. I've got absolutely no idea what's going to happen here because I just don't know. It's not my sort of race. Mm. I think handicapping racing when you have 10, 20 and 30 are very dangerous events from a punting perspective because some horses don't like the tapes being behind them and blah, blah, blah. Not my sort of race. Will be fun to watch, but so much is going to depend on who begins safely and who gets around. This is a good mare and Paul's got her back to her best. She might turn up in Bolton, I don't know, but you boys might have an opinion, I don't.
Well, what I would say, and what I did say on the show last Wednesday evening is don't back Habibti Ivy at the 260 the bookmakers were offering you. She was, Wilma's mate. It was way, way too short. She'd gone in there without a trial and a race. Sure, she got interference at the 800 metre mark, but she wouldn't have won that race anyway. I think this week, though, it's a different circumstance. You've only got one horse off the front, which is Ronald J. Then you're going onto a handicap. Those back markers are only off 20 this week, Greg. Wilma's mate, everybody knows, and Habibti Ivy, they're going to be in the field very, very quickly here. So if you like Wilma's mate last week, go this week because it's better off on the handicaps. As where Habibti Ivy is not, the 10-metre handicap advantage is gone from last week. It's evened it up. So the back three are the key in this race. I'd be very surprised if one of those three didn't win. I think they've got the clear advantage tactically and also on speed of the front runners.
Yeah, well, I expect all three to go to the Trotting Championship and then to the Anzac Cup and the Roe Cup. So that gives them an advantage, I think, this week. We've got the Trotting Oaks as well, the 15th running of this. The Stora Motors New Zealand Trotting Oaks it is. I think Zoe's Gift's terrific value here. Yeah. $6.50. She's beautifully bred. She's really good. Look, I know, Craig, that last week we saw Chevron Express win, but did sit in the trail, got the perfect run behind Arnold, did win the Hambletonian. There's a lot to like about her. She'll punch through off the back row behind Regal Love. I'll find out from you, Michael, in a moment about where she's at. And therefore, $2.20, that's the price the bookies have come up with. But I think Zoe's Gift's overs.
She won't start at 650, I can tell you right now. I had this race been 2400, 2600 metres, she'd be half that quote because she's not a real sprint horse.
Watch what happens here, Craig, because the last 100 metres is what I really liked
about
her.
Matthew Williamson has three looks here. He looks the outside, then you have a look, he has two decent looks to the inside. This filly was absolutely jogging it. She's got a nice draw, she'll go forward, and she's such a good star. Of course, she's out of an outstanding mare in Jasmine's Gift. I don't think she'll start at $6.50. I'd be surprised if she starts around $5 because she's trotting that well. And her main rival was second row, $2.20, coming off the trail to win last start. The only thing I'd say is significantly different halves. Jasmine, Chevron's Express ran home in a 27.25. That filly ran home in a 29.25. But barrier draws certainly.
If she'd drawn, say, you flip the draws around.
Absolutely. She deserved to be $2, but not from the second row.
No.
1900. For the second row, Greg, you've been at Addington every week for the last 10 years. Very rarely do they start at $2 and come from there to win.
Exactly. Also want to give a big ups to Brian Rabbit and the team at Addington Raceway and the racing department. I mentioned with the new handicapping system coming in that it'd be nice if you could see what class of horse they were before the ratings came in. That's exactly what we've done, and you'll see it on screen now. It gives you an opportunity to line up handicapping-wise where they'd be if we were still using the old system. So big ups to Addington on that. Short break for us when we come back. A lot more in store here on Your Box Seat. Let's wind the clock back to last Thursday. Very entertaining night out of Cambridge Raceway, including a new New Zealand record here, Craig Thompson, the beaten favourite. He was, of course, in the Young Guns final, Alta Maestro. There was no beating him tonight.
Different horse turned up 2 weeks later, Greg. They had a blood issue with him at Group 1 night, and he performed okay, but obviously not up to 100%. This was the real Alta Maestro off the gate. And he never looked back in a very quick 153 mile rate. Greg, he actually overraced in that race. He did a lot of things wrong, and he still was far too good for them. Cole Peck is a nice horse, but he was no match with Alta Maestro here. And as we catch the start, it was on for all at the start. Cole Peck was trying to lock Dexter early, and they just run a massive first quarter here, Greg, and that set up the New Zealand record. Now, Dexter's trying to take a hold here, but the horse doesn't want to take that hold, and he just progresses forward, and from there, he's just a passenger.
Is that going to be a problem for him in the future if he is in a position where he has to take a sit?
I don't think so, because all the juvenile trips are over the short distances. The juvenile championship used to be 2200 metres, but these days everything's 1950 or smaller. You put him where he is here, pressing to the lead in the duels, in the Sire Stakes final, in the Sales Series final. This horse, Barry Purden's horse, they are throwing down a huge, powerful gauntlet to the All-Stars. Let's not forget, this time last year, the All-Stars just won everything. Every two-year-old race they wanted to win. That's not going to happen. They're not winning this year because these are good horses in front. This is a very good Art Major. And the best young Art Majors are big and strong and rolling. I still have my doubts how far they go later in life. But this horse is going to have a lot of fun as a two-year-old. They toyed with the idea of going to Bathurst. I think they've done the right thing by not going there. They've come here. He can pick up one of the big three, Sale Series, Sale Stakes, or the Jewels. No doubts about that.
And potentially, he could win two, even three of them. That's how good he is. Yeah. All right, Cole Packer was very good in second. Let's have a look at the Neveliar Fillies heat, and you shall not pass. Threatened to win more than she has thus far. She's now two from eight, but she was too good here.
Interesting stat on this filly. Her last four starts at Cambridge, she's drawn barrier one in every single one of them. Couldn't win three maiden races and picks up here a very nice filly's race. I don't think the depth of this race is that strong. Lerato was good in second, but she's only a maiden filly as well. And the favourite American Empress, very disappointing. Never seemed to be comfortable Cambridge left-handed way round. And pace very ordinary for driver Salish Abernathy. Gave him a pretty awkward drive. But the winner was good. But again, I'm not sure it's a strong form race.
Well, when you look at the team Brian Hughes has around him, and Brian doesn't have 20 or 30 horses to play with, and they don't go to the sales and spend big money. He does a super job. He's one of those trainers who it's easy to forget how good he is. Here we see the race won at the start. She maintains the inside advantage, and therefore they can choose who to hand up to. But it's an overused word, astute, but Brian Hughes is a very astute trainer. And we're seeing that with horses like this. She may not be that special, but she might keep improving.
She covers the ground really nicely, and she's out of the family of Wait for No One, St. Bart's, Fight Fire with Fire. There's a bit of depth there as well, and now she's won a Neveliar heat. She's worth a fair bit too.
It seems a long time, fellas, since we've seen strong fillies racing in the North Island away from the Oaks. Our Neveliar heats in the North, outside the Orange Agent a couple of years ago, they just seem to be weak all the time. I don't know why that is, but we just don't seem to have two or three good fillies most campaigns. We tend to have one.
Yeah, I think, and when I said I don't think this is going to be a strong form race, that's nothing against this filly. But, I mean, Juice Brogdon's been in outstanding form. I mean, you've got Party On, Spanish Armada, Delightful Menace, Sea Swift Joy. Do you want, the list keeps going. Now, I'm not sure this filly is in that same category, and that's the filly she's going to have to race, whether she takes on the Jewels or the three-year-old races during the season. I think the barrier draw put in the right spot to win that race. Ideal fillies, very good.
Just a question there. Juice Brogdon wasn't in that. Is she not eligible?
She's not eligible. Hadn't paid up for her, so
hurts.
Hence why she wasn't there. What I can tell you is, though, she is heading to the Oaks.
Is there no late entry?
Don't know. I never asked.
I think there is a late entry for the night.
Yeah, I think there is too. Okay. Interesting there. From Cambridge to Auckland, and as Craig mentioned last week, great to see the numbers in the North being able to fill up the fields for both meetings. Don't Stop Believing. Pretty brave performance this, but the story out of the race was around the favourite.
Well, it was, and the race changed in complexion 200 metres after the start when Better Joy had a gallop and went back to last, and Morris could hold the front with this filly. She'd had no luck from awful barrier draws in her two previous starts at Alexandra Park. The draw aided her to be in front here, and she paid probably a little bit more than she probably should have paid. But that's in hindsight after the favourites had a gallop. Nice filly. Interesting background on this filly.
Yeah,
of course, Davey Butt partly owns this one.
Yep, and bred it along with his great mate Hoop. So this is the family of Natural. It actually goes back through Tribute, Going Royce, that family. So, there's a bit of depth there too.
Yeah, we'll have a look at the start of the race. And when Better Joy galloped 100 metres after the start, she's drawn barrier two outside the eventual winner. Tony Hurley's runner comes off from barrier three, and Nathan just decides he'll take a sit here, and the filly puts her head up here and goes into a gallop and then goes back through the field. That put her out of the race, and as you can see, there's a chain reaction, put a couple out of the race behind her as well. So, as I said, Greg, change the complexion of the race. Better Joy, she'll keep, but she's still not the finished product.
No, very much. Three things, key factor for me here. Don't Stop Believing, one of the best songs in the world to sing when you're drunk. Love it, by Journey on a good Saturday night out. Secondly, Robert Dunn and John Dunn want to get into two-year-old training. They realise that's where the money is, so they've won two feature two-year-old races inside 24 hours. That's no small feat. And again, what have we seen here from these three age group races? Leader or trailer. And every time you go to have a bet in an age group race, unless it's a proven Group 1 performer like an Ultimate Machete type horse, if you're not backing the leader or the trailer, stop. Think about it for 5 minutes. then maybe consider having a bet again.
The two-year-old fillies are totally different to the two-year-old colts, Greg. I tell you right now, any one of half a dozen two-year-old fillies can win on the day. The colts are a little bit more, a lot easier to analyse at the moment. We've seen the fillies. I mean, the Hoka Moon fillies won from the second row. This fillies won. I mean, we've seen Caitlin Clark, Spandau Ballet. We've seen, obviously, this one win here. They're a very even bunch.
It's a great thing.
And come to the jewels time, I reckon it's a great thing because what it is evening them up at the moment, making better fields, betting
well,
races.
And also, the best two-year-old filly in Australasia may not be here.
Yeah, and we'll talk about her very shortly. Speaking of jewels winners, Prime Power, the only group one that he has secured, of course, was at three. This was his first win since October. He was very good. He stepped well. He got into the race nicely, but the sliding blinds were added, and I think we saw a different horse over the last couple of 100 metres. He never looked like pulling up.
No, he didn't, and he sustained it from the 600-metre mark. He's a horse, Greg, that I wasn't sure we were going to see the best of again. Because he's just going through that patch where he's going great races but not winning. What Todd Mitchell did at the start of that race is he hugged the marker pegs early, got off at the 800-metre mark, and only had to make the run three wide. As I said at the start of the show, it's not easy coming off a big handicap, but he is beginning quickly, and he puts himself in the early mix, but I think the best Prime Power now is safe for one run.
Now, Michael, we spoke to Todd Mitchell. It's him stepping really quickly, as Craig just mentioned. Spoke to him about potentially coming to Christchurch for the Trotting Championship. What's put him off? They can fly down, but it's a three-day road trip back. Now, given he's got the Anzac Cup and the Row Cup. Now, the Anzac Cup is the sort of race he could win, because if he draws the front and he finds the lead, then he's very, very hard to beat. The other thing in his favour is, of course, no Markula, no Mombay. I don't know if Sonny Ruby's coming back. They're undecided there. Yes, Paul Nairn will bring his team up, but the depth in free-for-all trotting at the moment is not as deep as what it has been, and therefore he'll get his chance.
Yep, the Anzac Cup has him stamped all over it. I mean, he's not good enough, even at his best, to beat the big five. No, and the big five are Monbay, who's in the paddock, Stent, we haven't seen for the entire season, Master Lavros, who just appears to be all over the shop, to be honest. Speeding Spur, we'll talk about shortly, but dodgy at absolute best for the Anzac Cup, and Markula, definitely no Anzac Cup. So the big five are gone. Well, he's as good as the rest, and he has gate speed. So all of a sudden, the Anzac Cup is a flashing light for him. In racing, timing is everything.
Yeah.
Monbay's floating around. He can run second in the Anzac Cup at best. He can now win the Anzac Cup. Todd has never lost faith in the horse. He's believed in himself, the Macy's. I really hope that he can get another Group 1 because he deserves it.
Yep, he does. So he'll go, there's a free-for-all next week, 2200-metre mobile. Perfect for him with a two-week break before the Anzac Cup. Let's go back to Addington Friday night. Undercard, three-year-olds, Forgotten Highway. Outstanding, Craig, in 220, because what we haven't seen there is he got diggerised most of the way.
He absolutely savaged early. He came off a Westport defeat, which you were surprised. He got beaten first up, but Blair Orange here, very positive drive. 155 last mile here, so outstanding run, betting Shine On You Crazy Diamond.
Yeah, and of course he is Derby bound, potentially. Shine On You Crazy Diamond, who hadn't won a race, of course, and went down a nose on New Zealand Cup Day. 2,600 metres for him, 3.11, a really good run from him too, and we'll take a look at that in a moment as we see them come down to the line here, and Forgotten Highway was too good, but let's have a look at Shine On You Crazy Diamond.
Look, this again just shows to me that times mean nothing these days. They just go so fast, fellas. Mm. 5 years ago, they go 3.11 in an open class race, and you're like, oh, that's awesome, he's gone 3.11. They just go there all the time.
What was good about this, though, is most of his races, Craig, he's burned off the gate and got himself in position. The last two, Dexter's pulled him back. He's had to come round, sit outside, and was still too good.
I got this race completely wrong because I thought the Bachelor and Shine On You Crazy Diamond would both go forward. They both went back off the gate, and that actually won them the race. They stayed out of the early mix. There was an absolute moral beating in that race in Mighty American. Had Blair Orange got it clear early, it would have won that race.
He's in a race on Friday
and
night.
He'd be very competitive.
Yeah, yep, definitely. Let's have a look at Let It Ride. I know you're away, Michael, but you would have read about the times.
I was reading about this on Twitter and I thought, these idiots have got this wrong. Surely this can't be the fastest last 800 metres in Addington history. But surely I was wrong. This is phenomenal.
Yeah, he's really good. Ricardo, who didn't go off the gate, ended up having to sit part. I thought he was outstanding in second.
The first two were very, very good, and they both worked their way to the three-year-old features. But The third horse, unofficially, I clocked last night, is the fastest last half in New Zealand. Billy Badger actually went 0.2 of a second faster than the winner. He was last at the 800 metre mark and he got home in 53.6. So he's drawn barrier one this week. Give him a rough place chance at very good odds.
Also had the opportunity to catch up with Tim Butt about his new rising star. Well, Tim, while there's not a lot of mana nor money associated being the fastest horse over 800 metres at Addington, this relatively inexperienced horse is now holder of that mantle.
Yeah, quite interesting. I thought it would have been quicker, Greg, actually. But, it's something, you know, it proves that he's got the ability to go with the best that have raced there before. But, he's just untapped, really. He's probably preparation from away from winning a Group 1 sort of race. But, he's going to get his chance in the next couple of weeks to see where he's at.
It's a funny story how you even came by him, because you're actually invited to buy another one out of the house barn, as I understand it.
Yeah, well, I just like the way this horse went, you know, just the way he paced and the way we don't normally buy off Mickey too much, you know, and I just said to him, did he have any 3-year-olds for sale? And he mentioned another horse that he was keen to sell me, but I was more keen on this guy. And once we trialled him, he trialled terrific, and it was just a matter of moulding him into a quite nice horse, and he's getting there.
Look, the development from start one, where if you were on him at the winning post, the early stages of that race, you wouldn't have been overly confident because he put in a long hop, but gee, hasn't he come a long way in the next two starts?
Yeah, it's pretty hard, Greg, because you've got to screw them down, but he's as I said, he's a preparation behind, experience-wise, and it's just getting that balance right, you know, so, his raw talent's getting him away at the moment, but he just might get found out on manners, you know, in the real big stuff, so, this reason will probably go around in the $20,000 race this week and then prep him for the Derby and take our luck.
When you have the experience at Grand Circuit level that Tim Butt has, it's great to hear how philosophical he is about what happens in the next sort of 3 to 4 months, because he knows he's got the makings of a Grand Circuit horse.
Well, it's very similar to Rakapuka Rula. I mean, you look at the Derby next week and think, well, he's not going to win a Derby, is he? He doesn't know enough, blah, blah, blah. But Rakapuka Rula was probably not significantly more advanced when he won the Derby in the North. So I probably don't think he's going to beat those horses yet, but the three-year-old season goes a lot deeper than we sometimes think. I mean, it's easy for us to think Derby, then there's not that much apart from the jewels. But you go to Australia, there's Queensland Derbies over there, there's the Breeders' Crown. I'm not sure he's eligible for that.
He's in the Breeders' Challenge.
Breeders' Challenge. Okay, well, that's not a super strong bunch of horses. So there's a lot of options if you're willing to think Trans-Tasman. And Tim was one of the first guys to think Trans-Tasman. The good horses don't live in a region. They don't live in Auckland or Christchurch. That's why I'm not parochial about horses anymore. I don't care where they live. Mm. The good horses are like Brendan McCullum. They go where the action is, they get their money, then they come home again. So that could be the case for this horse. We may see him do, the Breeders' Challenge, which is the race, bizarrely, Waikiki Beach missed out on last year because they missed the norms.
What he'll have to do is be more professional in his races than what he's doing at the moment. Sure, he's gone a very quick last half in that race and a very quick overall time. But what he is doing at the moment is still not pacing that fluently. He's chucking the old long one in. You can get away with it in that group one, class two grape. You're not going to get that against Ultimate Machetes and the good ones, you know, the Vincents and the like, Rakapuka Rulers. They are professional racehorses. They don't do it. He can't throw in a long one and beat those good ones. I'm not saying he can't take the next step with good manners, because he can run the times, but he's just one of those ones I want to watch.
He might be a thinker, and maybe they'll go fast.
He's got that stallion about him like Heaven Rocks, Rock and Roll Heaven, so they're not all the finished product at this age group.
All right, let's go back to Cambridge from Thursday night, because we got to see a milestone, 100th training success for Anna Donnelly, and it's thoroughly deserved.
Well, it was, and a really good drive here by Andre Patama on Bet Out of Hell. Anna's best season will come this season. I think she trained 22 last season. She's already had 20 wins this season, Greg. She's been in the game for 10 years now. I think she's going to have a really good team around her. I've looked at some of the horses that she's got coming through the stable, the nice up-and-coming ones. And what I like about her, she sells the right ones at the right time. When they're getting there to their grade, she puts them on the market, they get sold, and she's got good owners as well. So congratulations to Anna. 10 years training, 100 wins. It's a pretty good effort.
And you know what? She wouldn't have had many horses on that property worth more than 20K. Like, she might have got a couple of 20K yearlings, maybe a 25er. But she wouldn't have had many, so she's done a great job. Another person who, if she got better horses, she could train a good horse. I've had a lot of time. I've dealt with her a couple of times. She transports horses. Mm. A couple of times she's moved a few horses for me. She's a very professional young lady. So, yeah. Again, you give her some better stock, and she could end up in Group 1 races easily.
Yeah, and good luck to her with her continuing efforts as a trainer. 100 wins, a great effort there. We're going to take a short break. She's trained 100. This bloke has trained 1. His name is Richard Bull, and the way this horse won, it can win again too.
It's Glen Toro, though, at the 100-metre mark. Margin 2 lengths, Black Art, Lady Danger storming home. But Glen Toro's in front. Lady Danger won't get Glen Toro. And Glen Toro, he got those angry peels out again, Craig.
Well, this was always going to be a cracking contest, Craig. The time Delightful Memphis went here, set up in front by Gordon Lee and Seaswift Joy.
Yep.
But gee, she was good in the end.
The type of run she needed, wasn't it? 151.9. The speed was on early here, and she got into the right spot on the back of Aim on Maguire, who sat parked out. And you could see at the 400 metre mark, Blair was just waiting to peel, and when he did, that filly extended nicely. She's only ever been out of the money once in 17 starts, so she deserved this, Greg. But it's that three-year-old brigade, isn't she? She's running into Spanish Armadas every week, but she's deserving to get a good win, and that was a nice win there.
Yeah, I reckon that might be a confidence booster for her. Let's go to the Bathurst Gold Crown. They tell me it's a wonderful carnival. And here is the Tiara and My Sweet Chili Filly. She might be quite good, Michael.
Yep. Now, she sat outside Lady Chato from Tim Butt's stable and, well, just brains it. Australasian record for a filly further than 1,600 metres. Wins by 22 and is a very, very big chance to come to the jewels. On what we're seeing there, she's at least as good, if not better, than our fillies.
We'll get to Lady Chateau, who's done a very good job, because here's what Tim Butt had to say about her recent Australian campaign. Tim, you must be delighted by the progression of this filly. She's come a very long way in a short time.
Yeah, big trip across the Tasman, Greg, and great week in Bathurst. That Gold Crown certainly hasn't lost its aura, you know. They really looked after us, and the filly went great. She's just beaten by a better filly on the night, and, you know, she looks an outstanding prospect, that other filly.
Yeah, all right, we're talking about My Sweet Chili Filly, of course. Gee, the money came for your horse on the night, though, backed into favouritism. Where did that come from?
Yeah, well, she looked great, and everything gone well during the week, but as I said, it was just down to who was the best filly, and they smashed the Australasian record for fillies, and especially on a Bathurst track. It's not over quick, so, you know, it's not a phenomenal run by both fillies.
What about your girl? What do you do with her now? She's earned herself a little bit of money. She comes home, I assume, and she'll go around in the better races here?
Yeah, she's not in the sire stakes, Greg, but she's actually in a race in the Pink Bonnet in Menangle in 2 weeks. I just felt if the other filly goes off a bit, and she's in Aussie, so then she's got 2 weeks to the Caduceus in Auckland. So, and that'll just decide what we do from there on.
So that was Tim Butt talking about Lady Chateau. Of course, the boys' section was won by Cast Along Shadow, but the surprise out of that, Divine State, mind you, he was asked a fair bit, wasn't he?
He was found to have an infection after the race. He's been stood down for 28 days, so I would say he's less chance of coming to the jewels. Shane Tritton has been courted by Harness Racing New Zealand to come to the jewels. He is keen to do so, could have two or three horses. That filly would look a natural. So there'll be some people out there looking at this going, look, we hear this Australian jewel stuff every year, some of them don't turn up, blah, blah, blah. You've got to keep fighting the good fight. I can't emphasise enough to people how important the Australian market is to our turnover. You can have any promotional campaign about getting kids on track, any promotion about bet on harness racing. We could talk on the show for 10 years straight. Nothing matters as importantly as engaging the Australian punters in New Zealand harness racing. It is the single most important thing alongside the race fields legislation in this country's harness racing economy going forward. Simple as that.
Yeah, it's going to be a big challenge for the Australians this year, though, because, OK, they can fly to Christchurch, but they'll have to road trip back, and that'll be 3 days. So there'll be an element there that,
The element is awareness. We had sent horses to the Breeders' Crown 20 years ago, then people go, this is actually pretty good, and they start to go. And now the Australians, through a lot of hard work from Darren Williams, are starting to go, it's a feasible thing to do. And as I said, once you get people engaging in the same way that we engaged 20 years ago in Australian galloping, that's where the turnover comes from. It's a long, complicated matrix. I could sit here and explain it to you all day. Just believe me. It's literally...
Yeah, but what I'm getting at is the travel is going to be further than what they've had to do in the past.
As you know, once they're determined, they'll come.
Yeah.
Because getting home isn't going to bother them as much as getting here. Getting here is the crucial part. Yeah.
So oh, you, I don't know. They've got Breeders' Crown and they've got a few.
But funny enough, it actually fits into a nice slot. It fits into a lot nicer slot than people feel. I think this year they'll get between 3 and 5. But the criticism inside the industry about it is, for me, just it's from naive people, people who don't understand the economy of harness racing in quite the same way that I don't understand shoeing, I don't understand some of the breeding specifics, but I understand how turnover and where it comes from. And we've got to keep engaging the Australians.
All right, we engaged with them with Speeding Spur. Of course, he's done so well across the Tasman in the past. We sent our intrepid reporter, Craig Thompson, out on Friday night to catch up with Josh Dickey to get the latest.
He's had a setback, but still not 100% sure where we're at the moment. We're able to jog him a week, and vet's coming back to scan him again to tell us the prognosis from there. So it's pretty tricky to work out at this stage. But we're still in the dark. You know, there's a few possibilities that could happen, but you know, we're not going to pray that you know, he could make these races early. But yeah, as I say, it's pretty tricky to know what can happen. And really, at the end of the day, the horse's welfare comes first. And if that means a few bit of time out in the paddock, well, you know, so be it. So he owes us nothing, and all we can do is look after him and his leg and hope for the best.
It appears from what we're reading through the media, it's a different injury to what was sustained earlier on. Take us through what happened in Australia. It was a swelling around the boot area.
Yeah, he had a bit of that, and it sort of blew up through the week, and the morning of the race, it was, you know, quite nasty. He was never sore or anything, but you know, with a horse like that, they just, you can't risk an injury like that. And the stewards in Australia were very good, and they seen the horse and his leg, and you know, everything was done by the book. And as I say, it's very tricky to know what's going on, because he's not sore or anything. There's just a lot of swelling, so no one really knows what can happen for the future for him. But I don't think it's as bad as what he had last year, and you know, hopefully we can get him back, and worst case we can, you know, hope for the Dominion or something like that, and you know, it'd just be great to have him and back racing.
Well, we all agree with that, Craig, although this ongoing problems issue that he's having are not, it's not an ideal scenario.
It's not, and I understand, talking to Josh last week, that they can obviously scan him this week. We'll know a lot more, but if they're going to get him ready for the Road Cup and the NZ Cup, it seems a very long bow to string, doesn't it? So we'll know a lot more, Michael, probably Thursday or Friday this week, and let's hope the prognosis is good, but it doesn't look good at this stage.
Well, it's better than it was. They thought he was retired. So in Australia, they got him scanned and thought he's retired, so that's unfinished. Now, speaking to John Dickey last night, because these things update all the time, he said he'll definitely race again. That's his opinion.
And that's a good thing.
Well, yeah. And John's a very experienced trainer, so I think he'll race again. He obviously has a stallion career to think about, so if there's another hiccup, maybe they'll retire him. I said, Road Cup, any chance? He said, mate, so that's an error. Mm. But the Road Cup now, because I spoke to Clint Ford yesterday, definitely no Mark Haller. It's sitting there for a Sonny Ruby or a Quite a Moment or a Prime Power to win, or maybe a Temporale or a Le Mans, because it's sitting there to be won by one of those next bunch of horses. If they could get him into the race, I think they'll have a crack at it, but it doesn't have a good feel about it, guys, when a horse who has to race at this top level already has had those problems twice, and he's only in his 5-year-old year.
We got some feedback from Michelle Blackie about a wonderful trotter through the early 90s. His name was Diamond Field. Unfortunately, he's passed away, leading towards his ripe old age of 31. But what an outstanding horse he has been. Of course, he won himself an Inter Dominion. He won himself a Roe Cup, Michael, a trotting championship. He actually had several trainers. Alan Beck started off with him. He won about 8 races for him. Then he went to Roy and Barry, who won 13. Then Mark trained him and he won 10. He ended up with Pat O'Reilly, who won a couple of races with him. So
yeah, he's one of those horses who came at a time when this happened a lot. There was horses who raced in the Deep South, and like David Moss was another one, and they were discovered in the South and they came north and raced for different people. Wasn't the strongest of a very strong open class crop, but he was one of those speedy, good-mannered type of horses, and it's hard to argue with a record like that. Lovely to see that Michelle's looked after him for what must have been 20 years, And when people look after those old horses for that long, I admire them. Mm. I think it's a wonderful thing for those wonderful old horses to have a great retirement. So well done to Michelle. You deserve a hero's, you know, congratulations for
one of my favourite trotters, because he was so durable. We knew him as a great star. He won a Road Cup, but I think one of his best wins when he actually defeated Idle Scott in the 1994 Cambridge Flying Mile, because Idle Scott at his peak was just such a hard horse to get by. So yeah, 31 years of age, it's a great effort, and very, very good horse.
All right, we're nearly in the home straight in your box seat. When we come back, we highlight the two-year-old superstars, I suppose, of the last 10 years of the duels. Find out who comes out on top. We're on the countdown to the Harness Duels, of course, split between Cambridge and Ashburton. We've had the 10-year anniversary last year of the duels, so let's have a look at our two-year-old Ruby champion, in our opinion. And it did come at the Cambridge venue, and it was, well, ultimately our best trotter in the last couple of seasons in Mom Bay. This was him, Michael, at his absolute best, and when we saw this, we knew we had something special.
Well, the two-year-old trot at the duels can sometimes be a little bit hit and miss. Some of them are quite good, some of them are quite average. We've seen quite a few horses go on to be open class horses, one over De Moon, an obvious open class horse, but this is something special. I mean, Mon Bay, fellas, super quick, super impressive. Beat a field containing speeding spur, so horses have gone on with the job, guys. Unanimous vote, the three of us all thought he was the best two-year-old trotter winner we've seen in the last 10 years. Next week, we bring up who's the best two-year-old filly winner, so two-year-old diamond, and I think there's a few more potentials there. If anybody at home has an opinion of the last 10 winners of the duels, who's the best two-year-old diamond, contact us at the box seat and give us your opinion. It's an open discussion, guys. I think there's going to be some divisions. We're going to count down one a week between now. There's our email address. One a week between now and the duels to see who is the best in each division, and then who we believe, and you at home, is the best ever duels winner.
We might come up with a prize. We could actually give away one of those flowers that you wear every week, Michael.
I'm not sure they'll be incredibly popular in the deep
south.
Well,
we'll put it into a package. Maybe the crackers will come to the party. I'm sure the bookmakers will. We'll get a bit out of them as well.
Maybe we can get a couple of $100 on a duels runner from the bookmakers. They've been having a pretty good time bit of late, so get involved.
Right. So basically, a division a week. Next week, two-year-old diamond, if you have an opinion on who it should be. I think this could be a split vote.
Yeah, it's not going to be easy, that one, that is for sure. All right, what about harness racing ahead this week for you? As we head to Forbury Park, the $50,000 pick six there on Thursday, 5:24 the start time of that. You get the same scenario, Michael, where it's 50 on that night and 25 on this. But anyway, $100,000 PGG rights and New Zealand Breeders Stakes, Stora Motors, Trotting Oaks, of course, five group races we have, the Superstars, the Flying Stakes and the Trotting Championship. And we have that late bonus quaddie, which should get to a decent sort of a pull, given that the $7,500 into that. Manawa 2, 5:19, the start time there, 10 races there on Friday to boot. And Methven on Sunday, weather report looks fine for that, $25,000 pick six there to wrap up their season on the grass. And of course, we head to Invercargill on Sunday as well, 12:17 the start time there. And the brand's back.
Oh yeah.
We found your home.
That's where I live.
Or you found yours.
It's in Parnell. Hey, just good thing this week, Premier Addington Friday night, really big meeting, no Alexander Park, good. I mean, take a guy like Tony Hurley. He wants to go down, drive the Orange Agent really hard if you've got six racing at home. All the trainers and drivers love it.
Yep.
When you have a really strong premier, don't race at the other metro track.
Well, unfortunately, next week they do. Anyway.
That lasted 1 week. That was an awesome
idea. Moving right along. Boxing bets of the week. Craig Thompson, you've found another first starter for us.
Yeah, first starter. I thought it trolled quite nicely. Drawn well. Barrier 6, I thought would be winning at Invercargill. Michael, you're with Ultimate Machete.
Yeah, I'm trying to get my money back from the Northern Derby. I'm not sure if that's exactly how it works, but I think he can potentially lead. And Gregor, you've gone Zoe's Gift, who the bookies are giving 6.5. Now, that's very generous.
Yeah, look, that's even maybe more keen on it. She's a terrific chance in there, certainly on an each-way basis, but the 650 is way more than I thought
won't
we'd ever get.
650. I mean, no. I'm considerably shortened up. I mean, they're thinking that if she goes good in the Oaks, that they'll line up against the boys. I think that speaks volumes of what Phil Williamson thinks of this filly.
Yeah, all right. You'll be looking forward to getting your line sorted out with all the winners
there
for
Friday. A lot of racing this weekend, boys, and I'll sit back on the couch and take it on Friday night. They're very, very good fields, great betting races, so heads up to the club.
All right. Looks like a night for the Maltese, but there's a couple of tricky races there, Michael, so I'm expecting one of the favourites to get beaten, just which one it might be.
Yeah, and a lot of them look two-horse races. Vincent, Ultimate Machete, the Orange Agent versus Piccadilly Princess. We'll find out whether the draws matter as much at Addington as they did recently at Alexandra Park. Just on the jewels before, of course, we haven't mentioned too much, Rockstar Angel has been invited for the four-year-old Diamond. Now, she's trained by David Aiken. I can't remember too many David Aiken horses racing in New Zealand, so having him here would be a good thing. They seem to want to come. How this unfolds in the next couple of months. What I was interested to find out when I returned from my holiday, apparently the hospitality booking's almost full at Ashburton. So
that's a good thing.
Well, it surprises me, really. Yeah. And well done to the club if that it is correct.
Well, the thing is, they have limited space, so therefore people realise that, having been there for the last sort of 5 out of the last 10 of the duels, so you've got to get in.
There's the rumours around, and they are abounding, that there could be changes to the sire stakes, the sales series, and the duels being spoken about at the highest level. Over the next couple of weeks at the box set, we'll try and get on top of those, but they could be rather significant moves.
Yeah, all right. We know Woodlands are great supporters of ours and their stallion, Sweet Lou. Well, you could purchase your own. They have a sale upcoming on Sunday the 21st of May. So go to woodlands.co.nz, check that out, and you could get yourself a horse with a big white nose.
Very outstanding individual, Sweet Lou, isn't he, with a white nose. And I think they'll sell well. And also, I think he'll do a good job because he's rightly priced in the market.
All right. Thanks very much for your input, as always.
Yeah, looking forward to your coverage on Friday night, boys. I'll sit back on the track and on the couch and enjoy what you're doing on track. And we'll talk about it next week.
You'll have Matt Cross there as well. You've ousted him from his seat.
And more Matt
with
Cross.
A salmon shirt. Yeah.
Well, since I've been away for 2 weeks, I'm going to ring the Wales Harness Hotline on Friday morning and find out when I'm back at Addington on Friday. I'll be sitting on the couch too, not the same couch as him, because that'd be weird.
All right, there are the boys for your box seat. I hope you've enjoyed tonight's show. We'll see you in 7 days' time.